But don't be fooled what's going on in this political system right now. For I'm the Lord thy God, I change men's hearts no matter who they are. And I'm in the business of changing people's lives and making people's lives better. And I'll make your life better, saith the Lord, if you will hearken diligently to my word. Don't get caught up into the religious fad that has killed my word and caused my people not to even walk with me. For I desire to walk with you. I desire to be your God. For I am the greater one that lives on the inside of you. I said in my word, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. I've already told you, you are. He said he just forgive me and cleanse me of all unrighteousness. How are you going to ask God to forgive you, and when you accept the Christ, you've been already forgiven? Now, let me tell you the whole piece of the story on that. If you read 1 John 1 and again, John said, we were with Jesus in the beginning, and I'm telling you about this eternal life that you also may have fellowship with us. And then you go down to verse 9, he says he that say he has no sin is a liar. But these guys were sinners. Okay? Then he said, if you just to forgive you and cleanse you of all unrighteousness. First of all, when you accept the Christ, it said you were declared righteous. How are you going to get cleansed of something you already been cleansed of? See, now, what happens is this. If I believe that God's going to forgive me, maybe in the back of my head, maybe he didn't forgive me. Now Satan uses guilt and condemnation and to make you feel bad based on what you do. And now it's hard to overcome the sin because you feel guilty. The Apostle Paul learned, Paul said, when I do good, he said, evil's present with me. He said, how to perform that which is good, I find not. He said, that I do, I hate to do, but I do it. And then he finally said, there's no guilt to those in Christ Jesus. He didn't ask God to forgive him because you already been forgiven. See, if I walk in that, Satan, the devil, call him, he's the guilt and condemnation character to make you feel guilty when you do bad. He'll trick you to make you do bad, and then you feel guilty. And then he says, well, I ain't going to church because, I just feel, God don't like me. God loves you. No matter whatever you do, God still loves you. And see, the body of Christ, they have this sin measurement thing. And other Christians judging other Christians. Not supposed to be doing that, okay? Because, the sin you did was a 50. And I only did a 10, but you still sin. He didn't call us. You got a full-time job to judge your own self. See, let me tell you, I'm for real. When I wasn't in the Word, I was for real. Let me tell you, I sinned good. I tried my best to sin, believe me. And I was good at it. So when I called on the Word, I found I didn't need marijuana. I didn't need all that stuff no more. I got at most high, the Elyon. That's higher than that. I had a Muslim guy tell me, he said, man, you higher than marijuana. I said, thank you. See? But you got to live this. You got to live this in your household. It's not just, people think about this a minute. We teach for 45 minutes. That's really enough. You want to know why? You take the CD back home, you listen to it, or you can get it on the app now. And people, you can't say you got to pay for the Word. It's on the app. I'm on YouTube. You can watch my channel on Roku. It's everywhere. You have no excuse to get Word. Turn off some of that news and put some Word in. And let me tell you, you'll feel better. Amen. I'm going to tell you like it is. See, all of us are a product, whatever go through our ear gates and eye gates totally affect our lives. That's why I work part-time for a service. I just say it like that. And then we go around churches, and I can't sit there and listen to some of that stuff. I had to walk out. Call me when it's time to come in, because I'm not putting that crap in my ear gates and mess up my soil. You know what I mean? You don't realize your spirit is soil. It's designed to seeds that to grow. It's going to grow seeds, whether it grow God's word seed or seeds that come. You're going to grow. Everybody's growing something. From the time you get born, you're growing. Whether it's God's seed or seeds that are contrary to God's seed. That's reading Mark, the fourth chapter says, when anyone hears the word, Satan comes immediately. And then it talks about how he comes with the cares of this world to choke the word, to try to make the word unfruitful in you. He's after the word. Now, Satan thinks the word is so important to come and get it. How come Christians don't think it's important?
You better talk.
It ain't about church, ladies and gentlemen. It's about relationship. See, I'm like this. I like church. I like the service. But let me tell you, I want to come and do what I do. Come hear the word. Get the word. I'm going to my spiritual father. I'm going to be there all day hearing the word. But think about it. But when I'm done with the word, I'm going to go home. Eat some chicken and fish or something. I ain't staying in church all day. What for? That doesn't prove nothing to God. Do you know what proves something to God? When you spend time and know how to know that word and start spending, and you want to get up in the morning and pray with him, and you talk to him all day long, and the Holy Ghost is talking to you and tell you, that's what pleases God. Not the fact you're in church, but the church
See, we go to church for the wrong. You go to church, the Bible said the first principle of God that you be taught the word. You go to get taught so you can take it back home and live it. If you go into church and you're not taking it back home and living it, what sense in going to church? I don't know. How can you do this stuff, Lord? Why? You know? But see, sometimes I got to, that's what you, Lord said, I have to break some of these religious barriers that are over people's lives. Got to pull some of that stuff back. We've been around too religious stuff too much, and it just makes my word of no effect. Like it takes time to pull it back. The layers have been put on, like something put on, and it's going to take time to peel it off. Sometimes repetition, you got to pull it off, because you got it by repetition.
Yeah, that's right.
2 Corinthians. But this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap how? Also sparingly. And he which soweth bountifully shall reap bountifully. Notice, if you sow sparingly, you're going to reap. Whatever you sow is what you're going to reap. If a farmer don't sow no seeds for tomatoes and sitting out there looking for tomatoes, guess what? He ain't going to see no tomatoes. He got to water it. Amen? Now watch this. But this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap also. He that soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. Now watch verse 7. Every man according as he purposed where? In his heart. See, I don't know what I get into today. There's a scripture talking about where your heart is, that's where your treasure be. You got to get it in your heart about giving. See, I give, but it's in my heart to give. Lord motivated me to give. And I can't stand manipulation. I was in the church, the guys called me up in the pulpit. I'm not fond of trying to sit in people's pulpits. That don't prove nothing to me. And I don't believe in men. This is my view. I don't really like people behind me on the pulpit. Because he's a minister. I want to put something in him. So what I'm saying to you, I went to this particular church, and guy told me to come on up to the pulpit. Then he turns around and says, oh, you ministers up here, I want you to get $50 a day. I had $100 that I was going to give him. He got $5. See? Because I don't like manipulation. I was in the church, I put an offering in this church, and the ushers didn't pick it up. And he looked at his, oh, Pastor Corprew gave $100 a day. I'm going to smack him. But I didn't. Because my giving is between me and God, not everybody else.
That's right.
It's private. It's personal. It's a personal relationship.
That's right.
Verse 7. Every man according as he purposes in heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or necessity. For God loveth what?
A cheerful giver.
He loves a cheerful giver. He wants you to be cheerful about your giving. Verse 8. And God is able to make all grace abide toward you, that ye always having sufficient all things, do abound in what? Every good work. Now notice, he said he's going to make you have all sufficient. Now understand, grace has already been provided for us. Grace is God's unmerited favor. Okay? Grace makes, faith takes. Everything that you want in life has already been provided for you, and it's in your spirit. The only thing you got to do is to correspond to what God has already provided. God's not going to do nothing. He's already done it. Bible says he rested. And in Hebrews, it tells us, let us labor to enter into his rest. Now, how do I labor? In the word. Because it said the word of God is quick. The word of God is powerful. The word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword. His word is powerful. And that's what religion does. It just waters it down. Amen. Verse 9. As is written, he have dispersed the poor, have given to the poor, and his righteousness remain forever. Now notice the part he said he give it to the poor. How can you give to the poor if you poor? You ever said to you? See, everything's about distribution. See, God didn't create me and get me saved just for me. He got me saved to help somebody else. It's always about helping other people. See, the world says, you know, it's about me. What about me? What about me? What about me? And God says, nothing, it's not about you. When I got, when me and my wife were married for a while, I said, my wife, she don't care nothing about me. And the Lord said, that ain't none of your business. I said, what? He said, that's not none of your business. He said, it's not about how much, whether she cares about you. He said, your responsibility is to care about her and pray for her, and I'll take care of her, taking care for you. See, when you get rid of selfishness out of your marriage, guess what happens? The love can flow in. What was it, baby? About a year ago, we did a marriage thing. We felt we'd been married, 37 years at the time. We was going to do a marriage thing together. Well, about a few months before, we were going around the house snapping at one another. She snapped at me. I snapped at her. And then one day we was in the kitchen. My daughter Tara was right there, too. In the kitchen, I said, you're wrong. And she was. I went out of the house, mad. Get in the car, and Lord said, now, you go back there and you fix that. I said, she was wrong. He said, ain't about whether she's wrong or not. You go back and ask her to forgive you. And do you know that spiritual, demonic thing stopped? Because it was Satan behind it. And he wanted to break up all marriages he can. That's what it's about. I went through a divorce the night before I got into the Lord. Didn't know. I got it. We ready to go to divorce number two. And I said, oh, no, here we go again. And I told her, you ain't getting the kid. Kids coming with me. I ain't losing no more kids. Didn't have baby. I'm serious. But then, my wife's girlfriend said, divorce the Kunchak. I don't like the N-I-G-T word, Kunchak, okay? Get rid of him. He ain't no good. Okay? And my wife said, nope. I'm going to pray over him. I'm going to speak God's word over him. She spoke God's word over me at night while I'm sleeping. Maybe people need this. I don't know. And she used to have an attitude. And I said, oh, no, another one. And all of a sudden, I come in the house. Sweetheart, what would you like to eat, baby? I mean, real sweet. And I said, oh, no, this woman going to poison me. She going to poison me. But you know what? And I was going through, she would grab me by the hand and say, honey, let's pray about that. I mean, she just became so sweet. And then she would pray. I said, oh, she prayed like that? I want to pray. Okay, God. See? And then all of a sudden, something came over me one day. It was like, I had to spend time. I closed myself in the room for almost 8 hours to listen to nothing but tape. Word, 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 word. Y'all that word, word, word. Y'all listen. Let me tell you something. You already letting words go through. You might as well listen to the word of God and let something happen. They're putting words to you all the time. I mean, you can go on, you listen to the radio, not careful. Whatever feels good, do it. Hey, just because it feels good not mean you're supposed to do it. Mama telling their kids, daughter go ask my mom, when's the best time to have sex? Mommy said, honey, when it feels right. Hell, you can feel right at 12, man. Get your wrong answer. Wrong answer. But see, here it is. We've been adapted to the law. And the law was never designed for man to follow. It was designed for Israel to follow. And they couldn't do it. And God never wanted to give man a law. But they kept on saying, Lord, we can do this, we can do that, we can do this. And God says, okay, I'm going to give you 600 of them. 600. And James said, if you miss one, you're condemned. In Deuteronomy, said, if you do this, God said, he'll do this. If you don't do this, you curse. If you do this, he'll do this. If not, you curse. Well, see, that was not written to us. We've been redeemed from the curse of the law. Amen. Thank you, Thank God. Because, I mean, a lot of black people would have definitely been in hell because the Bible said don't eat no pork. You've been gone. Them rivers would have took you right there. Amen. So we're not under the law. The Bible said the spirit of life who in Christ Jesus have made me free from what? The law of sin and death. I'm free from the law. See, the law is about don't do. The law increases sin, make you sin more, make you want to sin more. You know the deal. Somebody tell you. My mother told me, don't go around. When I lived in New York, don't go around. I was a child. Don't go around that corner. Some bad boys around that corner. But somewhere I had to get around there where the bad boys are. Why? Why you want to go around where the bad boys are? Sometimes you go around and get your behind whooped. But you still got to go around there. Because that's what thou shalt not do. Don't do, make you do. See? But when you do it out of love, and God's love on the inside of you, and you got the Holy Spirit, that's what the empowerment of the Holy Spirit is. And at the end, anybody want to be filled with the spirit of evidence of speaking in tongues, I'm going to make it available to you. Because it's important. It's very important. It's the power. Don't let all this business. Somebody showed me something that was on the internet where the guy was saying, tongues cause division in the body of Christ. That's dumb. Doesn't cause division. So you what you're really saying, the person said, it went away after the apostles died. Don't you think God got sense enough to tell us it went away, it was over with? And now I'll tell you the verse they use, 1 Corinthians, where it said, tongues shall cease and knowledge shall cease. Well, if tongues cease, that means knowledge shall cease. And he said, that which is perfect has come back. That which is perfect ain't come back yet. See how you got to rightly divide the word of truth? Well, Satan used scripture. He tried to use the scripture on Jesus. Told him to turn the stones into bread. Then he told him the angels are going to get charged over you if you do it. But he took that out of context the wrong way. Amen. Now, go to verse 10, and then I'll move along. I try. Now he that ministers seed to the sower, both minister bread for your... Go back. You jumped. Now he that ministers seed to the sower, both minister bread for your food. Now, a sower is anyone that's sowing the word. Right now, I'm a sower, and I'm sowing the word to you. So he said, he that ministers seed to the sower, both minister bread for your food. Do you know when you give to the man of God, the anointing is not on the church, the anointing is on the man of God? I have people put money in my hand and stuff change just like that. It's not about me. I'm not asking you for no money. Do what God tells you to do. That's it. I'm just showing you a principle that in the ear works. People want to say, hey, give to the church. Make sure the man of God stay poor. That's not what it's about, ladies and gentlemen. Did you know Solomon was one of the richest men ever was? And a woman came to give to him, and it said they had to make room for his gift. Solomon had so much. What did he do with all that money? I think I said last week, my spiritual father, he bought four cars or something like that, and the shame he got four new cars sitting in the driveway, just sitting there. You know why he did it? Because God told him to buy it. And then later, this family need a car, give it to them. You see, you see what I'm saying? You think so narrow-minded, and we're supposed to be thinking the best of every person. Everything doesn't appear what it looked like. See? Because God's, back to what I said earlier, my ways are not your ways. Amen? Now he that ministers seed to the sower, both minister bread for your food. Notice, get bread for your food. For your food in your house, and multiply the seed sown, and he increases the fruit of your righteousness. Now watch this very careful. Your tithing, everything has a connection. We don't tithe because we're scared we're going to get cursed, because you're not going to get cursed if you don't tithe. That was law. But there's benefits to tithing. The blessing is tied into the tithe. Abraham paid tithes to Melchizedek. And the Bible said Abraham was not just rich. It said he was very, very, very rich. Why? He honored God. I give tithes because I love God and what Jesus has done. Now, I'm not telling you you got to do that. I tell you to find out what the Word said, spend time with God, and let him prompt you to do it.
Amen.
When you're ready for it. Because if you just do it because minister going to say, tithing is, you know, you're going to be cursed with a curse because you didn't bring the tithes in. Your car broke down last week because you'd have tithed. It wouldn't have broke down. That's how much of nonsense. See? And then you're in a double play on that stuff. Has nothing to do with that at all. Now, go to what I want to get and go to Malachi. I got to see, can I cover this, some of it today? Malachi 3, because I just said it. Michael, do me a favor. Just close that door, please, because I don't want to hear that. Malachi 3, verse 10. Now, this is what they do. This is what they do. Will a man rob God? You God robber. That's what they do. Yet ye have robbed me, but ye say, well, he robbed thee in tithes and all. Ye are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, this whole nation. See, that's not it. You're not going to be cursed with a curse. Then he said, bring ye all the tithes in the storehouse, there may be meat in my house. Now, the purpose of the tithe is for the gospel to go forth and for the expense of the ministry. That's the purpose of the tithe. But God been on 10% a long time. Amen. I know I took this Bible up and read it. Sometime I'll do that too. Bring ye the tithes in the storehouse, that it may meet in my house. Prove me. Now here it was said, the Lord of hosts, if I would not open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, there should not be room enough to receive. Now that's still principle. That's still principle. It happens. But God's not going to make you tithe. Now go to Hebrews, the 7th chapter. Now I'm going to show you what you do with the tithe. So you understand, at least you get some understanding, you know why. Hebrews 7. My pastor, how you get all this insight? How do you know? Because I pray in the Holy Ghost. I pray in the Holy Spirit. And he gives me insight. Verse 1. Hebrews 7, verse 1. Watch this. But this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High, who met Abraham returning from the slaughter of the king and blessed him. Now think about this man. He met Abraham from the slaughter, and what did he do? He blessed him. Now, there is no record of a guy actually really living that was on the earth named Melchizedek. Nobody knew anything about no Melchizedek. And if you're going to learn, the Bible said Jesus Christ is a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. Next verse. To whom also Abraham gave a tenth part of what? All. First being by the interpretation of God, king of righteousness. After that also the king of Salem, which is the king of peace. Next verse 3. Without father, talk about Melchizedek, without mother. Now, this Melchizedek didn't have no father or mother. Where he come from? But Abraham brought tithes to him. He sure wasn't born out of a dog. Without father, without mother, without descent, having neither beginning of day nor end of life. Woo! That's something. But made like unto the... Made like who? What was he made like? Made like the Son of God. And abide a priest, how often? Continually. Wow. Now, watch this. Abraham paid tithes to Melchizedek, but under the law, they paid tithe to the Levitical priests? How come he stepped out of the scene? You want to know why? Because God was dealing with Abraham on great by grace, not by the law. Amen. Verse 4. Now consider how great this man was, unto whom even the patriarch Abraham gave the tenth of his spoil. That's the tithe, 10%. Verse 5. Now I'm going to say something. If you're putting your tithes in a dead church, ain't doing nothing, ain't talking about grace, ain't talking about nothing, let me tell you, your harvest ain't going to be too good. Now you could just be get some things happen just as a result of God's mercy, but I don't want to depend on his mercy, because the mercy, as he will, he might not feel merciful with his day. Amen. Really. And verily they that are of the sons of Levi who receive the office of the priesthood have the commandment to take the tithes of the people according to the what? According to the law. That is, of their brethren, though they come out of the loins of Abraham. Now, they came out of the loins of Abraham, but they're not operating the way Abraham operated now, by grace. Now, watch verse 6. But he who descended is not counted from them, received the tithes of Abraham, and blessed him that had the promise. So, Melchizedek that blessed him. Next verse. And without all contradiction, the less is blessed of the better. That's when we take money out of ministry and sow into my spiritual father's ministry. See, so everything come down. Amen. We get in the very glory December. We go all the way to get impartation. Oh, you say that, Lord? Wow, you know, Creflo Dollars, you know, what are he going to do for you? What is he? I have people say, what Creflo doing for you? You know what he's doing for me? He's giving me a spiritual connection that I can sow in. Hello. See? Even with the pastor, your spiritual connection is the key, not a physical connection. I don't have to have a physical connection, although I have an opportunity to be around. If I go to a church, he don't recognize, I really don't care. I know a guy got caught up because he didn't get recognized. I don't care if you recognize me. Wow. Let me put some seed in your hand when God tells me to so I get a harvest. Never mind all that. We caught up in the too much stuff. Got to be free. Get a life, man. Without all contradiction, the less is blessed of what the better. Verse 8. And these men, now watch, and here men that died received tithes, but there he received them of whom is the witness that he lived, a witness that Jesus lived. That's why we give tithes. That's when we have you present the tithe, we present the tithe to the Lord Jesus Christ, present them to the Father on our behalf as an act of my love and kindness to what Jesus had done. See, we forget about what Jesus has done. Do you realize that each one of you have the same Jesus faith on the inside that he had when he walked the earth? Jesus did not do miracles because he was the Son of God. The Bible says he walked the earth as the Son of Man. He was the Son of God, but he did not walk the earth with Son of God power. As a matter of fact, he didn't do no miracles until he was baptized by John the Baptist and the Holy Spirit came on in him. And you got the same power that Jesus had. The reason it don't work, Jesus spent time meditating the word. God told Joshua, this book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but thou shalt meditate day and night, that thou may what? Observe to do. If you don't meditate the word, how are you going to observe to do it? And he said, and then he said, then you shall make your way prosperous. It didn't say God's going to make you prosperous. It said you're going to make your own way prosperous. But see, this is stuff the devil don't want the church to know. Keep them ignorant. God says, Hosea 4:6, my people destroyed for a lack of knowledge. Verse 9. And as I may also say, the Levites also received the tithe and paid tithes in Abraham. Who received the tithe? The Levites now. See, no, they're under the Lord now. See, the Levites received the tithe. Verse 10. For he was yet in the loins of his father when Melchizedek met him. Back to Melchizedek, met him. Abraham. Verse 11. If therefore perfection were by the Levite priest, see, that wasn't perfection. Do you realize when you give tithes to the Lord Jesus Christ, that's the perfection there. That's the perfected way to do it. If therefore perfection were by the Levites priesthood, for under the people received the law, what further need would there be that another priest should rise after the order of who? Melchizedek, and not be called after the order of Aaron. Next verse. For the priesthood being changed, there is made a necessity to change also the law. What would have been changed in the law? Now watch this. Verse 13. For he whom these things are spoken pertain to another tribe, of which no man gave a tenth at the altar. Go to verse 19. 13, brother, I'm sorry. 14. For it is evident that our Lord sprang out of Judah, of which tribe Moses spake nothing concerning the priesthood. In other words, Moses didn't talk about Melchizedek. Okay. For it is evident that our Lord sprang out of Judah, of which tribes Moses spake nothing concerning the priesthood. Next verse. And it is yet far more evident, but that after the similitude of Melchizedek, there arise another priest, verse 16, who is made not after the law of carnal commandment, of fleshly commandments, of the endless life. See, that's the endless life. You follow the Lord, that's the endless life. Verse 17. But he testified, talk about Jesus Christ, thou art a priest forever after the order of who? Who's the priest forever? Jesus Christ is the priest forever after the order of who? Melchizedek. Next verse. I want to finish this. For there verily, truly, this is null of the commandments going before for the weakness and the unprofitableness thereof. That's verse 19 now. The command, it was unprofitable. For the Lord made nothing perfect. I said the Lord made. Do you realize your spirit man on the inside is perfect? Now, you might not be walking in perfection in your body yet. That's when you got to get the word so you can get better. You can't get better without the word. The word shall be more important than your job. Uh-oh. I said the word's supposed to be more important than your job. Do you realize you can get the word? Do you know you can change your bosses? Make them act better? They don't know why? I've done it. I had a guy one time wanted to fire me because I wouldn't work on a Bible study night. And he tried to do something, the force stopped him from coming near me. That guy really like, you don't have to work on Wednesday. Now what was going on with there? I made a commitment to God. See, don't put your confidence in men, put your trust in him. We got too much confidence in men. What men gonna do? One of my confessions every day, I not fear what man can do unto me. Told me, fear that I am with thee, be not amazed. I am the Lord thy God, strengthen thee, I help thee, I uphold thee the right hand. You Lord of holding me wherever I go, I'm upheld. Look at who do he think he is? I'm the righteous of God in Christ Jesus. That's who I am. Look at him. Don't even have a suit on wearing jeans. That ain't religious. That's right. It ain't religious. That's right. All right, the real. For the Lord made nothing perfect but bringing in of a better hope by which we draw nigh. Now we have a better hope, ladies and gentlemen. I said we have a better hope.
Amen.
I said, we got a better hope. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Heavenly Father, we thank you, we praise you. This word is germinating to each and every one. We give you glory, give you honor and praise for it now. In Jesus' name, amen. You can start that music. Why? Give you the opportunity right now to sow into God's kingdom. Don't tell you what to do, just do exactly what.